Hello and welcome to the broadcast today. I'm Bayless Conley, and I've got something great to share with you. Our oldest son, whose name is Harrison, he's the lead pastor of our church. He's driving the vision and just doing a great job, and he's a fabulous preacher. He brought this message to the church recently that just so blessed and encouraged us, so much so that I wanted to bring it to you today. So get ready, put your safety helmet on, put your seatbelt on, and let's listen to Harrison preach.
Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers.
Second Chronicles chapter 20. I want to read to you a portion of a story that almost every one of you will be familiar with. Story of a king named Jehoshaphat. And we begin in verse number 1. It says this: After this, the Moabites and the Ammonites, and with them some of the Meunites, they came against Jehoshaphat for battle. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A great multitude is coming against you from Edom, from beyond the sea. And behold, they are in Hazazon Tamar, that is in Gedi." We're just going to pause there for a moment. Just keep your place. We'll be coming back. But I want to make sure you're understanding what's happening here. We've got three enemy nations and their armies banded together to come against King Jehoshaphat and the nation of Judah. Jehoshaphat is outmanned and outgunned. And what's even more troubling about this whole situation is that all of this has taken Jehoshaphat by surprise. He doesn't even find out he's got a fight on his hand until these enemy armies are at a place called En Gedi. En Gedi is 30 miles from Jerusalem. It's a two-day march from where Jehoshaphat is. The story starts with a problem, but let me show you how it ends. If you got your Bible, drop down to verse 29. Verse 29 says, "And the fear of God came on all the kingdoms and the countries when they heard that the Lord had fought against the enemies of Israel. So the realm of Jehoshaphat was quiet, for his God gave him rest all around." The story ends with God being glorified in and through the nation. And I love how it sums it up. The realm of Jehoshaphat became quiet, and God gave him rest all around. So the story starts with a problem, but it ends in peace. Problem to peace. And I believe the same is true for your life. I believe with all my heart that God can and that God wants to take you from the place of problem and move you into the place of peace. And in the place of peace, He gets all of the glory, and there is quiet and there is rest for your soul. And if we could, let's just go back to the text this morning for a moment. I want to have a closer look at this story because I believe there's something here that God wants to show us. I actually believe He wants to show us a divine and an instructional pattern that will help us move along this pathway from problem to peace, right? It's a pathway that is filled with ups and downs. It's filled with highs and lows. It's a path that teaches us to put our eyes on Jesus. It's a path that teaches us to put our trust in His word. It's a journey that develops within us a genuine and a deep faith. It's a journey that reminds us to lean on His everlasting arms. The pathway of maturity also reminds us that if we'll lean on our own understanding and we'll lean upon our own strength, no matter how hard we try, we will always end up falling short. Make no mistake, this is not an easy pathway. But for those of us that have had to walk it a time or two, it's a pathway that we've become grateful for. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? So let's take a moment and let's talk about the pathway of maturity. Let's talk about the steps along the way that take us from that place of problem to that place of peace. But we have to start at the beginning. We start at the place of problem. And as we go back to the scripture, the first thing I want to point out to us is this, that oftentimes problems come uninvited and unexpected. Look at the first two words of verse number one. It says, after this. After this, meaning we need to actually back up in the story and get some context. And if you were to back up a chapter and go to chapter 19, you find that Jehoshaphat is a good man and that he's engaged in good things. As a matter of fact, he's bringing reform throughout his nation. Chapter 19, verse 5 tells us that he is literally bringing his people back to God. You continue reading in chapter 19, you see that he is establishing justice in the land. He's appointing righteous judges and priests into prominent places of leadership. He is doing good, but then we get to chapter 20 and trouble comes. And in like manner, when we are engaged in the good work of King Jesus, you better get ready for trouble. Because the enemy of your soul has painted a target on your back. Now, I know this is everybody's favorite message to hear, but following Jesus does not insulate us from, nor does it disqualify us from having to endure hardship, trouble, pain, or problem. If anything, the opposite is true. As a follower of Jesus, we are actually promised that we will experience hardship, suffering, and trouble, especially when you consider the world we are living in today, when you consider culture, when you consider that society is hostile to the gospel, when you consider that society is hostile to the word of God, when you consider that society is hostile toward Jesus and toward the followers of Jesus. Listen, it should come as no shock. We will have to endure trouble. Jesus himself said in Luke 6, blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you, when they revile you, because you follow me. You're like, thanks, Jesus. James, the brother of Jesus, he said in his book, James 1 and verse 2, he said, count it all joy, my brothers, when you fall, not if you fall, when you fall, into trials of various kinds. You don't need me to tell you, but trouble comes in all different shapes and all different sizes. It makes its way into every area and arena of our life. It makes its way into relationships. It makes its way into finance. It makes its way into our health. Listen, we will experience problems, but what sets us apart from the rest of humanity, what sets us apart from the rest of the world, is that as followers of Jesus, we have a promise of peace. John 16, 33, Jesus said this, in me, you'll have peace. But in the world, in other words, as long as you are on this sphere of a planet sucking oxygen, you will have trouble. Things will not always go your way. You will experience trial, but then he ends with a note of hope. He says, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. He says, look, in me, you have the promise of peace. But back to our original question, well, we have this promise of peace, but right now I'm in a problem. So how do I get from problem to peace? What steps do I need to take? Well, let's go to our text and see what the story has to teach us. If you got your Bible, look at verse number 3, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 3. It says this, then Jehoshaphat was afraid. He's just found out that he is being surrounded by enemy armies. Then Jehoshaphat was afraid and set his face to seek the Lord, and proclaimed a fast throughout all Judah. And Judah assembled to seek help from the Lord. From all the cities of Judah, they came to seek the Lord. So the problem comes, and Jehoshaphat's first response is that he set his face to seek the Lord. Now, the first step in this pathway from problem to peace is this, prayer. Let me give you a couple of things to consider. Notice verse number 3, it says, then Jehoshaphat was afraid. He was afraid. When you look around at the world we've been living in for the last year and a half, there's a lot of things that we've been told we're supposed to be afraid of. And can I just say that when problems do come, it's okay to be afraid because it's okay to be human. Just don't stay there. Don't stay in the place of fear. Know where you are supposed to go with that fear. David, the psalmist, had it right. He said in Psalm 56 and verse 3, when I am afraid, I will trust in you. We need to be intentional. And the king was intentional. He prayed. He declared a fast. He sought counsel from the Lord. And I just want you to notice how he prayed. We're going to read his prayer in just a moment, but it's important to notice how he prayed because I believe it gives us a template of how to pray when we find ourselves in trouble. Now, I don't know if there's a perfect prayer that we could ever pray, but I know this for sure. You'll never go wrong when you pray the prayers that you see written in the scriptures. And I want to read his prayer because within his prayer, we see four specific declarations, and it gives us a model of how we could pray. I want to read them to you. If you would, look at verse number 6. The king begins to pray. He says this, "O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? You rule over all kingdoms of the nations. In your hand are power and might so that none is able to withstand you. Did you not, our God, drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend?" Verse number 8 says, "And these people, they've lived in it. We've lived in it. We've built for you a sanctuary for your name, saying, if disaster comes upon us, the sword or judgment, pestilence or famine, we will stand before this house and before you, for your name is in this house." And I love this. "And we will cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear, and you'll save." Drop down to verse 12. I want to read the end of this prayer. It says, "O our God, will you not execute judgment on them?" Speaking about these nations. "For we are powerless against this great horde that is coming against us. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are upon you." Now, King Jehoshaphat makes four unique and specific declarations, and it's a template for how we should pray in times of trouble. The first declaration he makes is this, a declaration of who God is. We see this in verse 6. He says, "You are God in heaven, and you're over all the kingdoms and all of the nations." A declaration of who God is. And by the way, this is not a declaration to remind God of who he is. He hasn't forgotten who he is. This declaration is for our benefit. It reminds our soul of his power. It reminds our soul of his majesty and his greatness. And it gives us faith to trust him for help in our time of need. And it's in times of trouble that we need to ask God for help, believing that he's able to help, but also believing that he's willing to help. So in times of trouble, it's great practice to start our prayers with a declaration of who God is. Here's the second declaration that the king makes. He makes a declaration of God's past acts. He says this in verse number 7, "Did you not drive out the inhabitants or the enemies of this land? Did you not give us this land? Did you not give it to the descendants of your friend Abraham?" Listen, when we pray, we need to remember what God has done for us personally, but we also need to read the scriptures and we need to talk to our friends and we need to remember and we need to rehearse what God has done for us corporately. And as we remember these things, as we declare them aloud, we have to also call to mind that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that if he delivered you before, if he intervened before, he can do it today and he'll do it again tomorrow. We serve a faithful God. If he rescued us then, he's not going to abandon us now. And we need to declare God's past acts. And then we see the third declaration in his prayer. It's a declaration of God's promises. Specifically, we see this in verse number 9. The king quotes and he prays a promise that God had given to King Solomon and the people of Israel way back in 2 Chronicles chapter 6. He says this, this is the promise that God gave, that if we cry out in our affliction, you will hear and you will save. Listen, one of the best ways that we can wrestle with God in prayer is to plead and declare his promises. And you're like, where do I find his promises? Right here, this word, it's full of promises on every topic of life. We need to go to the word, find a promise and say, God, you said. God, as you've said, be it unto me according to your word. God, you said, be it unto me. Listen, prayer is not about giving God our grocery list. No, prayer is about finding God's purpose and his promises and aligning ourselves with it and say, God, you said, now let it be unto me according to your promise, according to your word. And in the fourth and final declaration that we see the king make is a declaration of our need for him. We see this in verse number 12. Listen, a spirit of humility is the proper way to approach God. We need to acknowledge our need for his help. We need to lay out the situation before him, not because it's lost on him, but because it helps us process. And we say, oh God, this and this and this. And then we make that statement of humility, the same statement that King Jehoshaphat made. God, I'm powerless against this. I can't figure this out on my own, but my eyes are on you. My eyes are upon you. In other words, God, if you don't intervene, I'm sunk without you. And there's something really pure and there's something really powerful about bearing our souls before God. And I'm telling you, if we'll come before him in honesty, if we'll come before God in humility, he will not turn us away because he's the God that rescues, he's the God that redeems, and he's the God that takes pleasure in showing mercy. Four important declarations. A declaration of who he is, a declaration of his past acts, a declaration of his promises, and a declaration of our need for him. And then one final thought on prayer before we move on to the next step. And again, there's just two steps in total. But the point of prayer is not just so that we can talk to God and get things off of our chest, but rather prayer, it postures our heart so that we can actually hear from him. Let me maybe say it like this. Prayer is never meant to be a monologue where I just talk to God. Prayer is a conversation. He speaks back. And by the way, I believe God is always speaking. And if you're not hearing him speak, the problem is not on his end, it's on your end. And when we pray and when we ask God for guidance, I think we need to expect him to speak. We actually see this play out in the text. They cry out for guidance and God gives it. You can read it, verse 14 through 18. But as the king prays, God speaks and he gives clear direction as to what they are supposed to do. And in the context of this story, God speaks through the voice of a prophet. Now again, in the context of this story, God speaks through a prophet. That's important because in that day and in that time, that was the predominant way that God would speak. That's the way God would communicate to his people, was through the voice of an intermediary, through a prophet. But when it comes to hearing God's voice in our day, in our time, and in our context, we have an advantage that these people did not have. We have the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit lives within us, and he's the counselor, and he's the one that leads and guides us into all truth. Now, having said that, do prophets exist today? Yes, absolutely. Is the prophetic real? Is it an office that's held? Yes, absolutely. Does God speak through prophets? Yes, 100%. But do you need a prophet to hear from God? No, you don't. God will speak to you directly, and he wants you to learn how to distinguish and how to identify his voice in your individual life. So as you spend time in prayer, as you set your face to seek the Lord, expect him to speak, expect him to direct you through his Holy Spirit. But again, going back to our text, I think there's actually a principle here that's worth noting. And the principle is this, that as you seek direction, God will sometimes use other people to communicate his will to you. Oftentimes, God will use other voices and other people to confirm what he's already been speaking to you or to confirm what he's already written in his word. Here's the rule. When someone says they've got a word from God for you, you always need to take that word and measure it against scripture. And if it's not in alignment with the word of God, it's not a word from God. As well, that word that's spoken over you, you need to learn to listen on the inside and see if it confirms what God has already been speaking to you. Listen for the Holy Spirit for that inward confirmation. He will confirm it through peace. The Bible says all of wisdom's pathways are peace. He'll either confirm it with peace or he'll give you a gut check and be like, I don't know about that one. It's really important because if you just blindly follow any word that's spoken over you, you can actually find yourself getting into big trouble. Because even if the one that's giving the spoken word over you is of a good heart and a good reputation, even if you love them and know them, listen, they're still human. And humans are fallible and humans can miss it. But even in more extreme cases, if it's someone you don't know, their intentions may not be pure. They may be trying to manipulate you for their own benefit. But again, to go back to this principle that we see here in our text, God will sometimes use prophetic voices to communicate or to confirm his will to us. So with that in mind, let me ask you this question. Who's that person in your world that you can go to that you know loves you and will pray for you and go before God on your behalf? Who's that person in your world that's of a good character, that's of a proven track record, whose voice actually holds a holy weight with you? Who's that person that you know genuinely hears from God, that is humble in spirit and is willing to help you process what God is speaking over your life? Who's that person? Is it a parent? Is it a grandparent? Is it a pastor? Is it a ministry leader? Is it a spouse? Is it someone in your small group? Because hear me, sometimes the best way to discern what God is speaking to you, speaking over your life, is to journey it out with a trusted person who loves you, who loves Jesus, who has a proven track record of holiness in their own life. But again, here's the greater point. As we pray and seek God, we need to expect God to speak back to us. We need to expect God to give us guidance. And one final word of warning. When God does speak and when God does give guidance, sometimes he may not give you the answer that you want or that you think is best for your situation. I mean, look at our story. I doubt very highly that the direction and the answer that King Jehoshaphat was looking for was, hey, instead of fighting, instead of building military fortifications, I want you to sing. What? That doesn't make any sense. I love singing. I'm all for singing. But naturally speaking, that is not proper military strategy. Right? In the natural, that's a recipe for disaster. But God's not limited to the natural. As a matter of fact, he does his best work in the unseen realm. He really does. And he does what he wants, when he wants, where he wants, and how he wants. That way he gets all the glory from our story. But it begs the question, what do you do when the direction that God gives you is different from what you were expecting it to be? What do you do? God speaks directly to you. You perceive the Holy Spirit is saying this. You go to the Word, it's confirmed. Somebody says something over your life. You go back to the Word, you're like, yeah, I think this is God speaking, but this is not what I thought he would say. What do you do? I got a one-word answer for you. Obey. We see this throughout the scriptures. You remember the man in the New Testament that was born blind and Jesus finds him, and the man thinks this is his moment. Jesus is going to lay hands on him. He's going to pray. He's going to receive his sight. But instead of hearing an eloquent prayer, he hears Jesus spit and make mud and put mud on his eyes. And then instead of immediately healing him, he goes, hey, go halfway across Jerusalem. By the way, I know you're blind, but go halfway across Jerusalem and find a pool called Siloam. You're like, but there's a water fountain right here, Jesus. Can I not? No, I want you to go halfway across the city and wash your eyes there. In the natural, it makes no sense. But God's looking for obedience. And he goes and he washed and he came back seeing. Think about the wedding feast at Cana. You remember Jesus' first miracle? Turns water into wine. Drinks at a party. Wedding runs out of wine. Jesus' mother, Mary, gets kind of upset about this, concerned, and goes, hey, Jesus, you got to do something. And she pulls the servants and she goes, hey, look, guys, whatever he tells you to do, do it. So Jesus goes, hey, you see those pots? Go fill them up with water. What? Like, in the natural, it doesn't make sense. But God's looking for obedience. And somewhere between them filling it up with water and taking a cup out and giving it to the master of the ceremony, it went from water to wine. The miraculous took place. We see this in the story. In prayer, King Jehoshaphat receives instruction from God, and in obedience, he marches out the praise and the worship team. He puts them in front of the army, and in so doing, he actually shows us the next step in this progression from problem to peace. After prayer comes praise. Praise. If you would, look at your Bible, verse 21, 2 Chronicles 20, verse number 21. It says this, and when he had taken counsel with the people, he appointed those who were to sing and to praise God and put them in their holy attire. And they went before the army, and this is what they sung. Give thanks to the Lord, for his steadfast love endures forever. And then notice this, and when they began to sing and praise, the Lord set an ambush against the men of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who had come against Judah. So they were routed. Couple quick thoughts here. Look at what the singers were instructed to sing. They were instructed to sing, give thanks to the Lord, for he's steadfast, he's faithful, and his love endures forever. You know what praise is? Praise is a declaration. It's similar to prayer in that regard. It's a declaration. It's a declaration, first and foremost, of thanks to God. Give thanks to the Lord. Someone goes, well, you don't know what I'm going through right now. You don't know the problem I'm facing. You don't know the year and a half that I've had. I don't have anything to give thanks for. How about start by giving him thanks that you woke up this morning and that you breathed air into your lungs? How about give him thanks that you're in your right mind? Give him thanks for all the times he has preserved you up until today. If you're watching online, that means you've got a computer or a mobile device. That's something you can give thanks to God about. How about give thanks to God for his grace and his kindness and his mercy? How about give thanks to God that his mercy, it's new and it's fresh every morning? How about thank God for salvation? Thank God that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life and that on your worst day, you're still going to heaven.
I hope you were encouraged by that message. And you know, you really don't have to look too far to find something to thank God for. There's an old song, old church song that said, you know, count your blessings, count them one by one. I thank God that I woke up in my right mind today. I thank God that he never leaves me, never forsakes me. I thank God that all the promises in Christ Jesus are yes and amen. I bet even if you're going through a rough patch right now, there are some reasons that you can give thanks to God. Why don't you do it? It'll shift the complexion of your heart. It'll shift the complexion of your attitude if you begin to give thanks to God for the good things that are around you. We don't deny the bad. We know they're there. We know that storms come. We know we're swimming upstream in a downstream world. But thank God he's promised he will never leave us. He will never forsake us. And my friend, you are loved by God more than you have the ability to understand it. Why not believe it and thank him for it right now?
Over the last 30 years, through Answers with Bayless Conley, thousands of lives have been transformed around the world. Every day through our broadcast, we are reaching people with the urgent message of the gospel. This year, because of the support of our generous partners, we've been able to share the practical answers that come from God's Word to people who may have never heard it before. We have received testimonies from people that move from fear to faith and from despair to hope. And right now, thousands of people like you are finding answers from the Word of God at a time when they need it most. It's because of the generous people like you who give at BaylessConley.com that we are able to continue. Everyone faces circumstances where they need the answers only God can provide. And right now, our television outreach is how many people around the world hear the message of Jesus. When you give today, you become part of the team, bringing people the hope that can only be found through Jesus. Whether it's through our broadcast, our online presence, or our products and devotionals, your gift enables us to put vital, timely materials in the hands of those who need it most. When you go online to BaylessConley.com, you can make a difference, both now and for eternity. Your support enables us to continue to broadcast, to continue to produce materials, and to continue to be a voice of hope. Please make a monthly or one-time gift right now at BaylessConley.com. Your donation says you care about others having access to the gospel. Please go online now to BaylessConley.com to give.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.